Saints' COVID-19 contact tracing czar is under fire for attending a birthday party, which is alleged to have violated mass gathering restrictions and physical distancing protocols.
Manila's health chief urges the public to respect President Duterte's decision to take the COVID-19 vaccine in private.
The Philippine National Police brushes aside criticism surrounding its presentation of supposed surrenderers from the New People's Army.
And U.S. President Joe Biden brings up Moscow's supposed interference in the 2020 presidential polls in his first phone call with Russia's Vladimir Putin.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Cruz.
And I'm Denise Dinsai.
You're watching Top Story. The Philippines' COVID-19 contact tracings are in hot water for attending a party which has been drawing flack online for alleged violation of COVID-19 protocols. But retired police officer Benjamin Magalong, who is also the mayor of Baguio City, says he was only present in celebrity Tim Yap's birthday celebration to thank him for promoting tourism in the city.
Ano kayo sa party?
Inimbitaho ako. Because ang nangyari po noon, prior to that, si Mr. Tim Yap and his group nagpunta po doon sa aming art exhibit. At ang dami ko nilang nabiling art. Alam niyo naman, no, yung mga artist namin, local artist namin, talaga nag-iikahos.
Opo.
So, mabuti na ho, dumating sila. Ang dami ko nilang nabili. That was on a Sunday.
Opo.
And then, tinawagan po ako if I could attend. So, pumunta po kami doon ng white coat to thank them. And at the same time, nakita ko yung mga post nila promoting tourism sa Baguio.
Photos and videos of that party went viral online. It showed attendees without face masks and disregarding physical distancing measures. Magalong admits there were lapses in the implementation of health protocols, but he's also defending the attendees.
May picture taking, may umiikot na picture taking. Siyempre, siguro sa excitement, yung iba na-excite, nagtatanggal na mask, pa-picture-picture. Pero ako, lagi ako nakamask. Even my wife violated it kasi natanggal nga yan because may picture taking. Nagkataon lang ho talaga na, you know, tao lang po tayo na sometimes when we are just so engaged in one particular po na activity na talagang masayahin, kumisan ho nakakalimutan din ho natin. Okay.
Following that incident, Magalong was bashed online for supposed double standards on quarantine violators. Now, social media personality Tim Yap also defending his decision to throw a party in the middle of a pandemic. He says it was only supposed to be a dinner meant to promote Baguio City's tourism. He adds all of the attendees tested negative for COVID-19.
It was never my intention to offend anyone. I would never do anything na makaka-endanger kahit sino man. Siguro magkulang ako na napapaalalahanin na magsuot ng mask dahil may mga lumabas na ng mga litrato at mga videos na walang mask. Pero again, I would never endanger anyone. We are all responsible citizens of this country, and all we want to do is to really help restart the economy, reopen the economy, and to push for local tourism.
But for the vice mayor of Baguio City, testing negative for COVID-19 is not an excuse to violate health protocols.
In our local laws,
opo,
mayroon kaming ordinance po,
opo,
na at all cost we should wear face mask in all public places.
Mm-hmm.
Kahit Manor is considered a public place,
opo,
in which I think if the investigation will come out,
opo,
probably they violated yung ordinansa natin dito sa siyudad ng Baguio.
Opo.
Kahit sabihin na negative po lahat sila na umakyat dito sa Baguio, that's good.
Opo.
But unfortunately, may violation pa rin sa local ordinance natin, which for me, yun po ay gusto kong makita sa investigasyon.
Aside from Baguio City's local government, the tourism department is also looking into possible violations committed by the hotel where the event took place last January 17th. The Philippines' summer capital is covered by the mass gathering restrictions imposed by the national government on areas under the modified general community quarantine.
Still in the Cordilleras in the Mountain Province, authorities are struggling to cope with rising COVID-19 infections. Dr. Ruby Constantino, director of the Cordilleras Center for Health Development, says hospitals in the area are beginning to be overwhelmed by surging cases.
Meron tayong kapulangan po sa ating pong health workers, kaya po kahapon ay nag-submit po kami agad first hour in the morning ng aming pong request sa central office,
mm-hmm,
for additional po ng human resources. So kasi mayroon na po silang pondo na agad-agad po ay inaantay na lang po namin yung pagpapapunta po kami makapag-immediately hire po ng additional para po sa ating mga hospital.
Mountain Province has confirmed 7 new COVID-19 cases. Its total is now at 683, which includes the 12 UK variant cases. Authorities place the entire province under stricter quarantine restrictions due to the threat of the more contagious coronavirus variant. Let's get more details about the situation on the ground. We now have with us on the line Bonifacio Lacuasan Jr. He is the governor of the Mountain Province in Northern Philippines. Governor, thank you so much.
Yes, ma'am.
Governor, I just wanted to ask, updates on the contact tracing efforts in the Mountain Province with regards to those who were possibly infected by the coronavirus variant in the UK.
Yes, the DOH are here to assist our contact tracer, and still the contact tracing is ongoing, and we are doing it even overtime.
Kamusta naman ho yung status ng mga ospital ho dyan? Kanina ho, nasabi ho ni Dr. Ruby Constantino na na-overwhelm na ho ang mga healthcare workers.
Yes, ang hospital po, tali dalawa po ang Bontok din at Manisway Department, and then we have the regional hospital, the Luis Hora Minoyan Hospital. Yan po, minamaximize po ang mga facilities doon para sa COVID nito, sa problemang ito.
Governor, ilang percent na po yung capacity ng dalawang ospital na ho na na-mention nyo ho kanina?
O sa Bontok din, mayroon 49 beds para sa COVID-19 patients. At sa Luis Hora, may 85 rooms for mild cases at 15 for moderate to severe, 15 rooms.
And so, yung mga symptoms ho ng mga pasyente ng mga COVID, majority ho ba mild or extreme, moderate?
Okay, kinakategorize po yan sa hospital. At kung asymptomatic po, may mga TTMF ang munisipyo at inaugment po ng province yan. May dalawang additional hotels na i-provide to be rented by the provincial government para ma-augment yung TTF ng munisipyo. At saka pag pumasa yung home facility, isolation facilities sa standard din, yun din po ang ginagamit sa, dito sa Monte Province.
So currently, Governor, ilang pasilidad ho ang hinihintay na ma-approve para maging isolation at quarantine facilities?
Opo, pina-accredit po yan, ma'am.
At ilan nga ho yung hinihintay nyo para i-accredit?
As of now, i-confirm ko pa muna sa kuha namin, sa health workers namin.
Okay, thank you so much. That's Governor Bonifacio Lacuason Jr., the governor of the Mountain Province in Northern Philippines. Thank you so much, Governor.
More news. An infectious diseases expert says authorities need to keep track of the studies being done on the new COVID-19 variants to come up with better responses to the pandemic. Dr. Edsel Salvagna from the UP Institute of Molecular Biology also points out the mutated variants stem from the continued transmission of the novel coronavirus. He also raised a possibility of reinfection among recovered COVID-19 patients.
The concern is that even people who've had the old virus infection before are maybe more likely to get reinfected with these emerging variants. There may be some decreased cross protection, but again, this data has not yet been confirmed, and we continue to keep an eye on it, and there are ways to rectify it, including tweaking the vaccine.
New testing and quarantine protocols here in the Philippines will be implemented starting February 1st. Passengers, regardless of origin, will now be required to undergo quarantine upon arrival. Travelers will also be tested for COVID-19 on the fifth day of their arrival in the country or earlier if they begin showing symptoms. The new rules come as the Philippines reports 2,245 new COVID-19 cases Wednesday, the highest daily tally since November 8th. The country's total case count now at over 518,000 with 32,384 active cases. Health authorities also reported 95 new deaths and 140 new recoveries. Meanwhile, the health department will look into the efficacy of wearing two face masks to avoid contracting COVID-19. U.S. top infectious diseases expert Dr. Anthony Fauci recommended double masking, saying it's common sense that having an added layer of physical covering can prevent respiratory droplets from spreading.
The Philippines will get around 1 million COVID-19 vaccine doses in February for an early launch of the country's inoculation drive. Vaccine czar Carlito Galvez Jr. says government is working on getting 500,000 doses from Sinovac, some 200,000 to 500,000 doses from AstraZeneca, and an unspecified number of shots from Pfizer. Galvez also disputes reports the Philippines will only be able to finish vaccinating 60% of the population by 2023.
Yung sa ating negotiation, wala tayong 2023 na negotiation. Ang negotiation natin is 2021. Ang pinaka late na delivery is Q1 of 2022. I believe mali yung basis ng economist, dahil yung ating procurement, ang timeline po niyan, ang delivery, main delivery is Q3 and Q4, and also kung just in case magkaroon ng delay, Q1 of 2022. Ang nakikita po natin, best case scenario, kung dadating po ang ating mga bakuna on time, it will be on the last quarter of 2021. And ang work case scenario natin is more or less on first semester ng 2022. So hindi na po tayo aabot ng 2023.
Galvez says government is working to lock in deals for around 148 million COVID-19 vaccine doses from several vaccine makers on top of the 40 million shots from the COVAX initiative. Galvez hopes the deals will be sealed within this month or early February. Overseas, the European Union slams pharmaceutical firm AstraZeneca, saying it provided insufficient clarification over its decision to slow down supplies of COVID-19 vaccines to the bloc. More in this report.
The European Union remains dissatisfied with what it called insufficient explanations from pharmaceutical firm AstraZeneca on delays in vaccine deliveries within the bloc. EU Health Commissioner Stella Kyriakides speaking on Monday.
The European Union wants to know exactly which doses have been produced where by AstraZeneca so far, and if or to whom they have been delivered. These questions were also discussed today in the joint steering board of the Commission and the 27 member states with AstraZeneca. The answers of the company have not been satisfactory so far.
She also said that in future, manufacturers of COVID-19 vaccines will have to register planned exports outside the bloc. And an EU official told Reuters that a transparency register will be implemented in the coming days.
We want clarity on transactions and full transparency concerning the export of vaccines from the EU. In the future, all companies producing vaccines against COVID-19 in the EU will have to provide early notification whenever they want to export vaccines to third countries. Humanitarian deliveries are, of course, not affected by this. The European Union will take any action required to protect its citizens and rights.
The EU's reaction comes after AstraZeneca announced last week it would fail to meet its first quarter supply targets to mainland Europe.
Indonesia officially surpasses 1 million COVID-19 cases. As this report tells us, it comes as the country struggles to get the pandemic under control.
It's a familiar situation across the world, but no less shocking. In Indonesia, the hospitals are full of patients gasping for breath, and graves are being hastily dug. The Southeast Asian nation officially passing a grim milestone Tuesday, 1 million coronavirus cases. The world's fourth most populous country has struggled since last March to get the COVID-19 pandemic under control. Deaths from the respiratory disease now total 28,468. Those numbers are among the highest across Asia. Health experts believe the true spread of the disease could be three times higher. West Java has been facing some of the highest infection rates across the country. Reuters spoke to residents in Bogor, a city south of Jakarta on Java Island.
This situation is very worrying. Maybe it's the lack of public awareness, but in my opinion, people just don't want to know about the situation, or they don't care about it. Things like wearing masks and washing hands should be mandatory. But even in big cities, they don't consider it an obligation.
If we believe that COVID will attack us, it will definitely attack us. But if we are sure that COVID will not attack us and we surrender to God, we will definitely not get it.
The Indonesian government started a mass vaccination campaign and tightened movement restrictions earlier this month. It can't come soon enough as hospitals come under mounting strain. Dozens of COVID-19 patients have reportedly been turned away due to a lack of beds and ventilators.
Philippine Health Secretary Francisco Duque III urges the public to respect President Duterte's decision to get the COVID-19 jab in private. While he hopes Mr. Duterte will change his mind, Duque notes the chief executive's choice is similar to that of England's Queen Elizabeth, who opted to not get vaccinated in public. Duterte's spokesman earlier said the president wants privacy because a vaccine will be injected in his buttocks. Duque sees nothing wrong with that.
Ang importante yung katanungan, yung bang epekto ng bakuna magiging pareho kung ituturok mo sa braso o dito sa may buttocks, no? Pareho lang po ang magiging epekto niyan. Dahil yan naman po ang kanya pong inilikha, ano, is the immune response.
Health Undersecretary Maria Rosario Vergere adds, although COVID-19 vaccines are usually administered intramuscularly, there may be some conditions which could warrant injecting the vaccine in other parts of the body, including the buttocks.
Up next, the U.S. Senate rejects an effort to stop former President Donald Trump's impeachment trial.
And President Duterte names Army Chief Cirilito Sobejana to be the next Armed Forces Chief of Staff. More news when we return.
You have to be a working manager and a leader at the same time. Your team will only do as you do and not as you say. So it's very important to set the right example.
People who are in the leadership sector should be able to walk the talk. You cannot preach about sustainability without making sacrifices, small sacrifices in your lifestyle. That's the key. It will redound to the individual behavior of the people preaching and of the people actually following.
Authentic community. By focusing on that particular core value, a lot of these Gen Zs and millennials can be themselves. They don't have to pretend anymore. As we prioritize the voices and the feedback of our young,
Welcome back to Top Story. The Philippine National Police's medical legal report rules out homicide in the death of flight attendant Christine Dacera. The report dated January 11, but which was released to the public only today, Wednesday, says Dacera's immediate cause of death is cardiopulmonary arrest. The underlying cause of death is ruptured aortic aneurysm, which was triggered by increased blood pressure. The report explains the loss of blood due to the ruptured aorta killed her within a few hours. It adds that while aneurysm is more common among the elderly, it could also happen in younger people. The report says that Santa's heart weighed 500 grams above the normal weight of 300 grams, which supports the Santa's undiagnosed hypertension. Dacera was brought by her friends last January 1st to the Makati Medical Center, where she was declared dead on arrival. Her friends have repeatedly denied any crime had occurred that night. The National Bureau of Investigation is conducting its own inquiry into the case. Let's now get insights from Filipino forensic pathologist Dr. Raquel Fortun. She's the pathology department chairperson of the University of the Philippines Manila College of Medicine. Dr. Fortun, nice to talk to you again.
Hello, good evening.
Ma'am, you've read the report and you've expressed some frustration about it. Why? What did you see in that report? What did you not see in that report?
Which report are we talking about? So far, I've seen two. And, well, actually, they're both frustrating because this is not how a forensic autopsy should be done. This is not a forensic pathology report.
Why? What's wrong with them, ma'am?
Well, the first one, well, the fact that you've got two, okay? That's not standard. What actually happened was the first report covered the what we call the gross or naked eye examination, so external and internal. And then the second one now apparently deals with tissues that were obtained the first time around and processed so one could look under the microscope. So this is histopathology. Mm. Now, actually, they should be together. You just release one final report with everything there. Actually, in an ideal scenario, even toxicology, you'd wait for that. So this is unusual that you would have two reports. So that's one of the questions I asked. Apparently, locally, it is not standard practice to do usual routine histopathology. So my question is, was this an afterthought? Was there too much concern regarding this case and therefore they thought, oh, we'd better do histopathology here?
Like an afterthought?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then it was pointed out earlier that it's dated January 11. So how come this was only released now? And then this is signed by another doctor, also identified as a medical legal officer. Again, what makes him different from the first doctor, also a medical legal officer, as identified? If this is histopathology, I would expect a pathologist, actually, to examine the tissues. So that's another question I have. And this is also unusual in PNP in the sense that there's a one-page description of the microscopic findings, but the second page is not something you often see in a PNP medical legal report. This looks into the... there's an opinion regarding right. The mechanism of death. Also, there is a conclusion regarding cause of death and even a determination of manner. PNP doesn't usually do this. In fact, I've pointed it out before. Their standard autopsy or medical legal report says that the purpose of the examination is to simply determine cause of death. But a forensic autopsy goes beyond that. So I have tried to dissect the report. So I have a lot of questions. Basically, it affirms what was earlier released by the first doctor. And the problem is, I think it's kind of twisted to simply fit the first doctor's report. So they did not deviate from the findings of the first medical legal officer. But that leaves you a lot of questions.
And we do have a lot of questions as well with the issues that you've raised, the inconsistencies and not the usual things that come out in the report. But let me ask you about the findings. Although this just affirms, as you said, this just affirms the first report that was released. Was there anything wrong with the findings? They concluded that it was still an aortic aneurysm that was the cause of death. These two reports, especially the second one, they did not confirm that or establish that as well?
Again, as a pathologist reviewing this report, I'm not convinced. It seems that this second report tries to address issues raised earlier. Like, for instance, I remember raising a lot of questions regarding if this is a ruptured aneurysm, how come the first report never mentions hemorrhage? Because that is how you die. If it ruptures, you bleed inside, and there's no stopping that bleeding, and then you die. This second report seems to answer, or tries to address something like that. Like, for instance, apparently a segment of the aorta was submitted to the second doctor, and there is a description here of hemorrhage outside the aorta. But as a pathologist, I'm not that convinced this is real. Some other questions I have. It's really not convincing to me, especially how it was concluded that since the aorta is deceased, therefore the manner of death is natural. I can't buy that. There seems to be, again, an attempt to explain away, because that's another big issue. You have a 23-year-old, apparently previously well, no known illnesses, no medications taken, and now she's suddenly dead. And then the second doctor explains that, yes, he examined the surface, inner surface of the aorta, and it's smooth, and there is no atherosclerosis there, which is the usual scenario. But taking everything in consideration, bottom line is this is not really convincing that is indeed the cause of death, and the manner is simply natural.
So
the cause of death statement here does not explain how she died.
Right, again, so you're saying that this report seems to be made to affirm, to back up the first report and explain the other issues that were raised after the first report was released. And may I ask, are these explanations under that opinion heading that you were saying a while ago?
Yes. As I said, the second page is kind of unusual, that they would offer an opinion and then a discussion on the mechanism. And I find this kind of pushing it too hard. Again, if you are a pathologist or if you are any other medical doctor, would you agree to the discussion here? In pathology, we teach our residents to come up with a an autopsy report, and yes, as part of the training, they come up with what we call a summary and interpretation, mm-hmm. or S&I. Mm-hmm. And I would say, I'm a teacher, this is a very awful summary and interpretation because it doesn't make sense to me.
So whoever did that, if that person was a student, your student, he would have failed.
I would definitely not agree with what's written here. In fact, in a forensic autopsy report, we do not allow S&I because the resident typically speculates a lot about what happened, and that's very dangerous if you have a forensic case. And this is actually what we have, mm-hmm. a very sensitive forensic case where you have to be clear about many things, especially cause and manner of death.
If the allegations of rape are going to be pursued, is there any other way to find out at this point if there was rape from the existing samples that the authorities still have? Of course, you mentioned before that the body has already been embalmed and the autopsy happened after the embalmment, and the body of Christine has been buried. From the existing samples, is there any way the angle of rape can be pursued? The urine sample that was taken, perhaps?
On the issue of sexual assault, that is best addressed if you look at the totality of evidence. So that means scene, body, circumstances, everything. Mm-hmm. And to me, it's late. The first report where the doctor described the external injuries and so on was very non-specific in terms of, was there non-consensual sex that happened. A second report on histopathology is not going to address that. Regarding toxicology, that is something we'll have to ask NBI about because they did a second examination of the body. I really don't know their results. They're saying they were able to get urine. Mm-hmm. But again, that raises a lot of questions regarding how helpful is that going to be. But bottom line is, have we established cause of death here? I don't think so. Not based on the two documents released by PNP. So maybe it's more prudent to wait for what NBI has to say.
Forensic pathologist Dr. Raquel Fortun, thank you very much for your thoughts.
Army Chief Cirilito Sobejana set to take the helm of the Armed Forces of the Philippines. Sobejana will replace General Gilbert Gapay, who will retire next week. Malacanang says it is confident that Sobejana will continue to modernize the country's military and will push for reforms to make the armed forces truly professional in its mandate as protector of the people and the state. Sobejana assumed leadership of the Philippine Army just last July. He is a recipient of the country's highest military award, the Medal of Valor, for his bravery during a gun battle with the Abu Sayyaf terror group in 1995.
The UP Diliman Student Council slams pro-government groups who tried to hold a protest march inside the campus in support of the abrogation of the 1989 UP DND Accord. Council Chairman Froilan Carriaga says the Duterte Youth and the League of Parents of the Philippines only represent the interests of the Duterte administration. He also describes as hypocritical Defense Secretary Delfin Lorenzana's claim that the accord was abrogated to protect students.
In fact, the AFP and the DND and the NPSLFAC themselves are the ones endangering the very lives of UP students and UP community. Every time po na nandere-red tag sila, every time na sinaclaim nila na merong NPA and communist recruitment among within campus grounds sa UP Diliman and sa other UP units po.
Meanwhile, former UP lecturer Michael Eric Castillo says The university has yet to provide any legal or practical justification as to why its accord with government should continue. Castillo says the accord has little significance to academic freedom and is premised on the mistrust of law enforcers and the military.
That was 1989. You know, every public policy, you know, we review that because the effectiveness of a policy is contingent on the prevailing context. When a certain policy is already out of context, then that ceases to be effective. Why would a mere presence of the military and the police preclude the university and the students from, you know, pursuing critical and progressive thinking?
The long-standing accord, which was terminated by the government earlier this month, bars state forces from entering UP campuses without permission from the university administration.
The Philippine National Police on the defensive following criticism over its presentation of supposed surrenderers from the New People's Army. Social media users have pointed out the alleged former NPA rebels could not be recognized due to the masks and face shields they were wearing. But the police force says it is necessary to hide their identities for their own protection. The police also downplays observations. Some of these surrenderers do not even look like communist rebels, as they were wearing either an expensive watch or they have keys to their own vehicles.
52 years of fighting the NPA has already changed the complexion of the game. We indeed have realized that the NPA members may not only necessarily be those we can see in the mountains. They're also right within the system of government. Insofar as those NPA members who wanted to hide, of course, insofar as their identity, this is part of making sure that they will not have some sort of a repercussion to be fighting those other members who still, you know, who would like to get back at them.
The International Monetary Fund lifts its global growth forecast for this year, pinning hopes on a vaccine-powered pickup in the world economy. The IMF now sees the global economy growing 5.5%, better than its previous 5.2% forecast. As for 2020, the fund sees a global contraction of 3.5%, less severe than expected. It says vaccine approvals and the launch of immunization drives boosted hopes of an eventual end to the pandemic. But it warned the world economy continues to face uncertainty due to threats posed by new COVID-19 variants.
If there is additional policy support provided, outcomes could improve. But on the other hand, if you could have if there is going to be a slowdown in vaccine rollouts, and if there's a premature withdrawal of policy support alongside a mutating virus, then that could certainly lead to worse outcomes. Now, the projected growth that we see for this year follows a severe contraction in 2020. Now, even though the estimated collapse for 2020 is somewhat less dire than we had projected in October, the crisis in 2020 still remains the worst peacetime global contraction since the Great Depression.
The IMF sees the U.S. economy, the largest in the world, growing 5.1% this year. China's economy, meanwhile, is expected to expand by 8.1% in 2021.
Philippine shares extend their losses for a second straight day as the International Monetary Fund downgrades its growth projection for the country. The decline also comes ahead of the release of the country's fourth quarter GDP print. Michelle Ong reports.
Philippine shares underperformed Asian peers on Wednesday as investors digested another downgrade in Philippine economic numbers by the International Monetary Fund. While upgrading growth forecasts for the global economy, the IMF now sees a bigger contraction of 9.6% for the Philippines for 2020 and a slower recovery of 6.6% for this year. Official Philippine fourth quarter and full year 2020 GDP numbers will come out on Thursday morning.
In the past 2 weeks, we've been seeing the volumes drop, at least for the index names. The market's really trying to price in the effect of the lack of access to vaccines. We stay around these levels at 6.7, 6.8, maybe 6.9. Without a positive news flow, I just don't see any upside.
For the day, the PSE index tumbled by 114 points as foreign funds sold out of the local bourse again, this time to the tune of 1.4 billion pesos. Regina Capital also cites latest trade balance and agricultural data as another reason for the drag. It says improved consumer spending during the holiday season could be offset by lower agricultural output. In corporate stories, ATN Holdings, operator of one of the country's largest rock extraction sites, will resume operations soon after the Environment Department cleared its quarrying operations in Rizal Province and said it was not the cause of a massive flooding in Marikina at the height of Typhoon Ulysses last November. The company says it's looking forward to contributing to government's 1.3 trillion peso build program for 2021. Meanwhile, after an initial drop, MacroAsia managed to swing up at the close. It disclosed receiving a letter from the provincial government of Cavite that the notice of award for the $10 billion Sangley Point Airport project, granted last February 2020, has been canceled. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
Heading now to Washington, the U.S. Senate rejects a Republican effort to stop former President Donald Trump's second impeachment trial. But it shows there may not be enough votes to convict Trump. Here's a full story.
Will all senators now rise and raise their right hand?
U.S. senators on Tuesday were sworn in for the impeachment trial of former U.S. President Donald Trump, the only president to have been impeached by the House of Representatives twice and the first to face a trial after leaving power. Right off the bat, Republican Senator Rand Paul attempted to halt Trump's upcoming trial on the basis that it is unconstitutional because Trump is no longer president.
Article 2, Section 4 of the Constitution says, "The president, vice president, and all civil officers of the United States shall be removed from office on impeachment for and conviction of treason, bribery, or other high crimes and misdemeanors." As of noon last Wednesday, Donald Trump holds none of the positions listed in the Constitution. He is a private citizen.
That effort failed, but 44 Republican senators sided with Paul, including now Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell, who said just last week that Trump provoked the mob that stormed the Capitol. Only five Republicans voted down the effort, which signals a weak appetite among GOP lawmakers to convict the former president. Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer hit back at the notion of constitutionality.
By constitutional text, precedent, and common basic sense, it is clearly and certainly constitutional to hold a trial for a former official. Former President Trump committed, in the view of many, including myself, the gravest offense ever committed by a president of the United States.
That offense being the incitement of insurrection by Trump supporters on January 6th while Congress was in session to symbolically certify Electoral College votes confirming Joe Biden as president. The trial is set to begin on February 9th. At least 17 Republicans would need to join all 50 Democrats in the evenly divided Senate for Trump to be convicted. A two-thirds threshold that appears unlikely to be reached.
Mr. White House.
U.S. President Joe Biden raises the issue of Moscow's supposed interference in the 2020 presidential elections in his first phone call with Russian President Vladimir Putin. The White House said Tuesday Biden made clear to Putin that the U.S. will act firmly in defense of its national interests in response to potentially harmful actions by Russia. But he also discussed other issues with the Russian leader, such as the willingness of both sides to extend the new Strategic Arms Reduction Treaty for five more years. The Obama-era accord is set to expire next month after Washington and Moscow failed to reach a deal under the Trump administration.
More to come, a deadly blast in Cotabato kills at least two people.
And a worldwide climate survey shows most people view climate change as a global emergency. Stay with us.
What happens when you apply Vaseline?
You have to be a working manager and a leader at the same time. Your team will only do as you do and not as you say. So it's very important to set the right example.
People who are in the leadership sector should be able to walk the talk. You cannot preach about sustainability without making sacrifices, small sacrifices in your lifestyle. That's the key. It will redound to the individual behavior of the people preaching and of the people actually following.
Authentic community by focusing on that particular core value. A lot of these Gen Zs and millennials can be themselves. They don't have to pretend anymore. As we prioritize the voices and the feedback of our young,
watching top story, a bomb blast in the Philippine province of Cotabato kills two people and wounds at least four others. The explosion took place near a bus terminal along a national highway in Tulunan town Wednesday afternoon. Tulunan Mayor Pip Limbungan says it is yet to be determined whether the blast targeted a bus which was unloading passengers at that time. The first fatality was a vendor near the area. The second was wounded in the incident and later suffered a heart attack.
The Philippines files a diplomatic protest against China's new law, which allows its Coast Guard to fire at foreign ships in reefs claimed by Beijing. Foreign Affairs Chief Teodoro Loxin Jr. says, while enacting a law is Beijing's sovereign prerogative, leaving it unchallenged means submitting to it. He adds the law involves the contested South China Sea and is a, quote, verbal threat of war to any country that defies it. Luxin's statement comes only 2 days after he said the new piece of legislation is none of Manila's business. China has refused to recognize a 2016 Hague ruling, which concluded that Beijing has no legal basis to claim historic rights to the bulk of the territorial waters. And before we go, despite a raging pandemic, almost two-thirds of people around the world also view climate change as a global emergency. That's the main takeaway from People's Climate Vote, the largest opinion survey yet conducted on tackling global warming. The poll was organized by Oxford University and the United Nations with more than a million participants from 50 countries. Almost half of the participants are aged between 14 to 18. Conserving forests and land emerged as the most popular solution for tackling the issue. Renewable energy resources, meanwhile, came in second. Cassie Flynn of the United Nations Development Program says the poll proved a groundswell of support for climate action, something that world leaders should take on board. And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Densai.
And I'm Ron Cruz. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thanks for watching.